So the first thing I have to say is I'm here by accident because I'm not, certainly not Pooja Bhatt, and she was supposed to be talking to Dr. Merchant, but I happen to be here. I've published him, so we decided till Pooja comes, I'm going to step in and just be with him, giving him company on the stage. We're actually here to listen to him, obviously. I said to Dr. Merchant, where shall we begin talking about this, about addiction and alcohol? And he said, it's a very simple question, actually. Ask me, is alcohol good? Is it bad? Doc.
Okay, so now, can everybody hear me? Nothing is wrong with alcohol. Nothing is even wrong with drugs. Nothing is wrong with sugar. But for the diabetics, sugar is a poison. For the addictive personality, alcohol and drugs are a poison. Now let's look at what happens. I think out of 10 people who drink alcohol regularly, 2 become alcoholics. 8 cannot become alcoholics even if they want to. So what's the story? The story is very simple. For 2 out of 10 people, their brain starts producing a neurotransmitter. It's known as tetrahydroxyisoquinoline. So his pattern of drinking changes when that happens. So let's say if I was drinking for maybe 5 years socially and suddenly this neurotransmitter started being generated. Now what happens is that the neurotransmitter intensifies my craving. So normally if I was drinking, after drinking I feel satisfied. But now when this switch has happened before I become an alcoholic, when I drink, I need to drink more. It becomes a vicious cycle. So I'm primarily drinking to get smashed at that point in time. Can everybody hear me? Should I be standing or, oh, this is good. So shall I repeat the whole thing again? So basically I was saying that when your brain starts producing a neurotransmitter, THIQ, your drinking of alcohol changes. Nothing is really wrong with alcohol. But alcohol in a combination with the addictive personality, at some point in time, is going to, now I do not drink at all. But I know I have the addictive personality. So if I drink, maybe 3-4 years I'll drink as a social drinker, and then I'll turn into an alcoholic. Now why does it happen? Whom does it happen to? I'm talking about alcohol and drugs. It happens to people, like I said, who have the addictive personality, who basically have a low boredom threshold, are very intelligent like me, it's true, who have an inability to deal with stress like I used to, and they don't seem to be finishers. They're very good starters, but they can't finish because they're very, very sensitive. So I just want to define for you once and for all, what is the problem with alcoholics and drug addicts? The problem is that alcoholics and drug addicts are superior misfits into society. If you understand what I mean. They are misfits, but they're not misfits because they're inferior. I think they're misfits because they're more intelligent and they're superior. And because, I mean, I keep referring to myself, I'm a self-referential person. So you cannot straitjacket Doc into anything. So he is a person like Doc. He cannot be straitjacketed. So because he cannot fit in, he gets too stressed out and he has to resort to an escape. And of course, I mean, only an addictive personality has this problem. So if he wants to escape into alcohol and drugs, his whole personality changes. He becomes this self-consumed, selfish human being who goes around hurting people around him. But if you see addicts in recovery, when we meet addicts in recovery, you find them to be better than normal human beings because they are better human beings. You know, I mean, I'm talking about me. I cannot imagine, and I'm not saying it's a bad thing, but I cannot imagine of fitting into a world where I have to travel 2 hours by train, smelling people's armpits, and then go and perform exactly on cue for 7 hours or 8 hours, and then again go back smelling people's armpits home, and being happy with the whole process. I cannot do that, the alcoholic cannot do that, the drug addict cannot do that. So I think that basically, in the chemical way, if you go to see, it is just one chemical that your brain is producing. It's a neurotransmitter called tetrahydroxyisoquinoline. Now, socially what happens? Because once it becomes a need is something like, you know, I need oxygen, I need water. Now interfere with my need and see what I do. So the bichara then, once he's trapped in that need, he starts behaving like a monster, which probably even Dr. Yusuf Merchant will do if you stop him from breathing, because that is my need. So because of this THI, it happens to drug addicts also, it becomes a need. So interfering with the need creates a lot of problems in his environment. You know what I mean? And the, all human beings have a tendency to believe that we were not doing the wrong thing, or we never do the wrong thing. So he looks for justifications. And that's the way it goes. I mean, that's the way his life goes. And for a long time, I think, in this whole problem, the people in the family sometimes are enablers. Because I don't want to deal with your tantrums. So the best thing is to give you money. I mean, yesterday I got a patient, a mother. I said, why are you giving him the money? He said, no, because it creates too much of a scene. I said, let him create a scene. If it's the wrong thing to do, don't give him the money. But they don't want to play that game. So every time he disappears from the house, the parents say, this, has he died? Has he expired? Did he have an accident? So they just pack up for anything. So I think, I mean, I hope you all have got the point. Nothing is wrong with alcohol. But if you have the addictive personality like Dr. Merchant has, then please don't do it. Please stay away from it.
Tell us, what is an addictive personality? How do you recognize it in yourself or in someone else?
How do you recognize the addictive personality? Like I said, one, he has a very high IQ. He has a very low EQ. So he has an inability to deal with this perceived stress that is coming out of the gap. He gets bored very quickly. And he is more sensitive than other human beings. Now, sensitive has two sides to the coin. Like when we say sensitive, we always think, you know, sensitive means I get hurt very easily. There's another side to sensitive. I love sensation. So I love chaos. I create chaos in my life, any kind of sensation. So the addictive personality will be either a substance abuser or an alcoholic or a gambler or a womanizer. Anything he will do that guarantees him chaos. You know, because he's addicted to chaos, and primarily also because he cannot deal with boredom. So I think in when the people join our rehab process, we actually address these issues. And for me, because of that, he does not have a connection. And for me, the opposite of addiction is connection. So only if we get the, these people connected, because they're not connected. They're not connected to anybody. They're not even connected to themselves. Therefore, the drug thing works. So I would say the person who does not have connections is a very, very good candidate for all these things happening. And what I mean by connection is true. And even I didn't have any connections till I was 28 years old, because I had low self-esteem. I thought I was a... Now, of course, I smile. I thought I didn't look good and all that, because I also lost my hair. And I had low self-esteem. So what I would do is, I would project an image of Doc. You know, the cool dude who doesn't give a shit about anything, you know? And the more people loved that cool dude, the more I hated me. Because I was the only guy who knew I was not that guy. So the more it got accepted, the image, the more I hated me. So it was like a weird trip. So I think for the addictive personality also, it's like this. Now the question is, see now, how do you recognize if someone has become an alcoholic? If he can stop at one or two pegs, no matter how many years he's drinking, it doesn't matter, he's not an alcoholic. But whenever he drinks, even if it is once in 2 months, but he drinks to get smashed, he just can't stop drinking once he starts, then he's an alcoholic. Because this, as I said, tetrahydroxyisoquinoline, the neurotransmitter, intensifies the craving. So an alcoholic will find it very easy to delay the drinking. He cannot reduce the quantum. So I could be drinking once in a year and be an alcoholic. Or I could be drinking every day and not be an alcoholic.
But isn't addiction mean that you want to keep doing it? Like, how does this once a year drink binge become addiction?
No, because what happens, for me, the classification is only based on one fact, if THIQ is being produced or not. That means if THIQ is being produced, Now, let's say if I start drinking once in a year, I'm going on a binge. I will not get have a social extension of my problem, right? But let something happen in my life, let someone die in my reality, let me have a great loss, I'm going to resort to that. And then you will see the daily pattern. So I'm talking about prediction in the future. Like, for instance, you can just predict in schools which kids will probably would be the high-risk kids. You know, they definitely will be compromising on their attendance. And the teachers would know that there's something wrong with this kid. Because absenteeism would be, it would begin with anti-authority behavior. So if you're a school teacher and you think that, you know, these two, three kids are a little anti-authority, so they are our candidates. And what we need to do is connect with them. What we do is we send them out of the class and we beat them up. So actually you're making it better for them. Because remember, for an alcoholic, alcohol is the solution. So the more mom screams at me, the more society ostracizes me, the better it works. Because basically, it is not giving me, I mean, it's not doing anything good for me once I become an alcoholic. I'm just using it as a need. So when you ostracize me, when you are negative towards me, you make my need even stronger. So the thing actually works better.
So Doc, have there been a lot of cases where you've tried to help someone and it just hasn't worked? They just keep going back to it?
Yes, of course. See, when I started, for the first 2 years of my treatment, when I was a doctor, nobody gave up even by fluke. So everybody was going back. Now, say we have come to 85% success rate, 15% go. Now, I give the same advice to the same therapy sessions with everyone. But it works for most people, it doesn't work for some. So what I have figured out is that I am the least important part of the process. It is the patient who decides whether he wants to get clean or not, and that's what is working for him. I'm not working for him at all, because he interprets what I'm saying to suit his needs. So I've come to realize that Dr. Merchant can't help anybody. I don't even help anybody. I give everybody data, and the people who want to use the data, use it. The people who don't want to use the data, don't use it. Because if Dr. Merchant was working, then everybody should give up. So I seem to be an incidental guy in that whole process. So all I'm saying is that, one, I have failed, I don't know, if I total my failures, there would be more than 1,000, much more than 1,000. But I keep trying to learn from my failures, and I know one thing, that I have to give data to the person, and I have to try to, my only one line for everybody is that belief is everything. And get connected. So if I can manage to convince him that he can do it, then he's going to do it.
So are there specific techniques you use?
No, I mean, the specific techniques or something that we have is based on the fact that the brain is neuroplastic. What I mean is that the neurons that fire together will wire together. Now let's say if I'm an alcoholic, maybe it's evening time, maybe it's dim lights, maybe it is guzzles, maybe it is something that triggers, because that is the way it is hooked onto me, alcohol. So what we do is, we do repeatedly do a hell of a lot of exercises, which actually contributes to him actually changing his brain. Because the brain is just a physical organ, the mind is a brain in action. To change your mind, you have to change your brain. And that's very easy. So we do a lot of exercises besides doing progressive relaxation. Besides, I think this chanting is very good. I encourage praying. Then because the personality of the alcoholic is such that he is unable to switch. He appears to be very impulsive. I'm saying even before alcohol. So what we do is, we help them to every fourth day we do an exercise of switching. We keep helping them to switch so that the density in the anterior cingulate gyrus, which is responsible for switching, is established. So we do that, we help them, because see, for me, I would like to explain this point to everybody, our present is only based on our past. So what the program actually does is helps them to reappraise the past. Because I can only use the past to make sense of the present. Now, let us assume that Kartikeya was this evil human being, you know, and she had this kind of a thing, bisleri with acid in it, and she'd keep, whenever comes, she keeps throwing it on my face. So my brain has established a pattern that this bisleri bottle is dangerous and Kartikeya is dangerous. Now in life, even 20 years later, if I see a bisleri bottle, I'll start shitting in my pants. Or if I see something that looks like Kartikeya, maybe Nilanjana, I will start shitting in my pants. So basically the trauma, the pain, the hurt, usually of early childhood, you know, is getting his whole life stressed out, and alcohol works for him. So what we do in the program, one of the techniques, important techniques, it's called reappraisal. We help and encourage the programmers to reappraise the past. And I think when that happens, I think then things start moving. There are lots of techniques we do. We do another thing called catharsis, which I suggest all of you should do. Like if I'm negative about my mom, about my dad, about anyone, I keep it to myself and it starts influencing my thought processes. And the program will help you, we encourage you to do a catharsis. So if you were in my program, if I was in my program, this was another patient, every morning we would be paired, and for half an hour, I would finish an unfinished conversation with another human being. I don't have to tell Kartikeya, you're my mom, but I can talk to my mom. And I just finish an unfinished conversation, because these things are very, very important. And I think, I mean, as for me it is like this, and I think it must be like that for the world. There is nothing more important in life than meaningful relationships. What I do is I've created a space where one can, it's a little non-judgmental space, where one can form meaningful relationships. I think that's the most important thing in life. It doesn't really matter how much your bank balance is or whatever you wear and all. What is important is how many people you have a meaningful relationship, which means how many people are you bonded to, which means how many people can you be real to and express your real feelings to. So I have a definition of emotional bonding. Emotional bonding is a healthy state of connection wherein the other individual's feelings and well-being are as important as your own. You know, an emotional bonding creates a space, a non-judgmental space, like I said, where both can be comfortable being their real selves and to reveal their real feelings. That is what a bond is. And I think that's what my program does.
One question leading from that. You talk about the individual brain, what happens to them. Are there patterns you've recognized over the years of the class or community or gender or anything that seems to you as more likely to be susceptible?
No, I think that everything seems to be changing. You know, because when I started treating, I used to only treat drug addicts and alcoholics, and generally they would present themselves in their late 20s or 30s. Now we have, the youngest patient in my rehab is 13 years old. So, everything is changing in terms that the ages are getting, they seem to be getting younger with the same problem. Of course, even if you're not talking about alcohol only, drug use has changed. The only difference we see is that in high-class families, actually I don't know the names of many alcohol things, but must be Shivas Regal or something. And in the middle class, it must be XXX rum. And in the lower class, it must be Tharra or whatever. But it is the same, and the pattern is the same. And the pain to themselves and to their families is the same. In all cases, it is like this. If you see the very, very... But everybody is using it as a solution only. Haven't you all seen a lot of people who drink alcohol and they're fine? There's nothing wrong with alcohol. It's like saying, because they're diabetics, let's ban sugar in the world. But the diabetics must not take his fucking sugar, no? So it's like there's no point in, if you think it's bad for you, you don't take it. So genuinely nothing is wrong with alcohol. So, I mean, if you go to say, I mean, if the party is over, I don't know what this thing is called, but something like some cool name this session has, when the party is over or after the party is over or something. After the party is over, there's no problem. If you have a problem with alcohol, don't go to the party or don't drink, no? For you, it is fine. So I don't want to make alcohol into an evil thing because it is not. It is not. I mean, it is for me. If I take it, I know because I have the addictive personality. And by the way, I'd like to tell you why I made a decision never to drink alcohol. I was 17 years old. I'd gone to London. My uncle, he was an alcoholic. So, to cut the story short, we were sitting in a bar and I had ordered tomato juice. And he came in and he said, "This one's on me." And the whole bar was freaking out. Jay, Jay, his name was Jayant. And while we were going home, and he was wearing this Macintosh and he was swaying, I said, "Fuck, man, this is a cool thing. I'm going to do it." And we went home and he, in UK, his, I think his living room was down, his bedrooms were on top. He went on the sofa and went to sleep. And then after some time, and I decided, tomorrow I'm going to go and have this, whatever they were having, you know. And his wife calls me up and she tells me the same thing that I've seen in a different way. She's holding my hand and saying, "Did he say this one's on me? Did he say this one's on me?" And he had said, "This one's on me." And then she went to tell me how he blows up his entire cash in one night. She has to work as a laborer to so that the children get some food to eat. And the same, that whole heroic thing and the great thing. I said, "Man, because what I saw in the bar was not what I saw at home." So my uncle used to go and blow up his entire salary in one night in a bar, treating everybody else to alcohol. And his wife was a laborer. I said, "Man, this is not my scene. I mean, I don't want to do it." The second time when it got consolidated was when I was in the Department of Psychiatry at JJ Hospital. Over there, I saw three elderly people sitting on the bed and crying. So I went up to them and said, "Why are you crying?" Because they were like my dad's age and all. So they said, "Pau jameen pe rakh nahi sakta hai." So I just picked up the, you know, they have a thing at the back which has a diagnosis. And it was written alcoholism, this guy had peripheral neuritis. So I had learned that peripheral neuritis is a burning sensation in the limbs. I did not know that the burning sensation is so painful you can't put your leg on the ground. It's a crazy thing because it actually burns. I was just like, okay, a tingling sensation. You know, I was in that zone. So that was the second time where this whole thing got consolidated. Within 1 month, I don't know, have you heard of cirrhosis of the liver? Within 1 month, I was supposed to do help a person with cirrhosis of the liver drain his ascites. And we are taking out 1 liter of water from his peritoneal cavity every 3 days. I said, "Oh my God, I mean, is this what alcohol really is? Because I didn't think alcohol is all this." So for me, it's a total no-no, especially because I know I have an addictive personality. Like now also I'll work for 18 hours a day and I'm very happy working for 18 hours a day. I don't know if, maybe I could have been straight jacketed, then maybe I could drink also, I don't know. But nobody can put me into a jacket. So I'm that kind of guy.
So, Doc, you talk about work. You just said you can work 18 hours a day. So, can, if you are an addictive personality, suppose you are addicted to alcohol or drugs or something, can you substitute another less harmful addiction in order to cater to that addictive personality's need and yet take away the dangerous part of it?
No, but the first thing you'll have to do is stop that original need, no? For that original need would have to go away first. Once it goes away, then it's possible substitution. And I would only say the only thing I would recommend substituting is by work. I mean, even if my patients substitute it by prayer, I mean, there'll be weirdos. Imagine after giving up alcohol, you're going to the Himalayas and doing Om, Om for the rest of your fucking life. I mean, that would be a weird life. And whatever you want to do, So I would, for me it is like that. I mean, but at the same time, see my daughter is here. That is Bliss. Bliss, can you put your hand up? Love you, Bliss. Now, I'm an addictive personality. I would love to sit with her together for the rest of my life. And it would still be not enough. But I'm not going to do it. I've been in and out. Because if I do it, I will destroy her life. So I have the sensibility to know the dog you have to have an in and out of everything. Even if my wife sings, there has to be an in and out. But for my work generally, I mean, I think the only thing I do in the extreme is work. Because I need to do, oh, and I also smoke in the extreme. There are two things I do in the extreme. One is work and one is smoke.
But Doc, is this something that if you have an addictive personality, is it likely she's going to have an addictive personality?
Yeah, 100%. I think she also has an addictive personality. My dad also had it, my mom also had it. See, nobody in my family has drunk, right? My mom has not drunk alcohol. But she was a Hindu. She would do 2 hours puja in the morning, 2 hours puja in the evening, have sabudana vada, this, that. Her addiction was satisfied with her religion. For my dad, he was a workaholic, plus we had lots of race horses. I think gambling is also considered an addiction. For me also, if I wasn't an addictive personality, I don't think I would be a doc also. Because when I was studying, I used to study 18 hours a day. When I'm shitting also, I'm revising. You know, so if I'm doing one thing, I just fucking do the same thing all the time. So I think it is and she's also an excellent student. Now, I think my addictive personality, it is genetic, has been expressed in my case. It is not expressed in my brother's case. So you can have a gene running in the family and it may not express itself. I'll just tell you a little bit about genes. The Levi's genes, Wrangler's genes, no. I'll tell you a little bit about those kind of genes. True religion genes are the best genes. Okay, now genes are, if I would take a DNA strand, and I said true religion is a good gene. If we take a DNA strand of the gene, it will be taller than me. And they are in all cells of the body. So the only way you can keep such a big structure is by wrapping it around a cell. It's wrapped around a protein. It's like a string. You can wrap it around a protein called histone. Now these guys have switches on them. They're epigenomes. So I think the important thing is not the genes, the genetics, it's the epigenetics. So if your lifestyle or, like say if I had a diabetic gene, but if I also eat more jalebi and don't exercise and all, it'll express itself. But if I'm doing everything right, the gene will not express itself only. So I think even though it is genetic, it runs in the family, you know, but it may not express itself.
So tell us about a case which was very difficult, which came to you in whatever way and however it expressed itself, and you felt the real satisfaction of having helped somebody. Give us one story.
I don't know. I mean, I'll answer that question, but I feel satisfaction anyway. I mean, whether the guy makes it or not. I mean, because I'm just doing what I'm doing. If he makes it, I feel happy for the guy. But I can tell you a tough one. One very, very tough one, you know. This person, I won't name him, who started, because alcohol also causes psychosis, if you don't know. It doesn't only destroy your liver, it doesn't only destroy your bones. You need a hip joint replacement. It also destroys your brain. It's called OBS, it's organic brain syndrome. It can be caused only by alcohol. Generally, it's caused by alcohol. So a person who was a combination of a snake and Shiva, he would just sit and keep doing that. You know, that guy has become normal. So when that guy has become normal, I mean, I'm not talking about satisfaction, but it feels really nice. It feels really nice.
But what caused that kind of problem?
Alcohol. Well, people don't see what happens is, if you say hash is bad, alcohol is bad, nobody believes me, because when it's good, you see the people. When they go bad, then I see them. So the guys I see, you do not see. And the guys you see, I do not see. Because the guys are having normal, why will he come to me? So I would say that, you know, this starting from being a combination of Shiva and a snake, and over a period of 18 months, you know, gradually improving and becoming normal, I think it's fantastic. It's not even like normal. It is normal.
The other point that we spoke about earlier once was that a lot of people who fail or who are unhappy about something, don't have connections, etc., sometimes get to be addicts of this kind. But the bigger problem sometimes seems to be the one who becomes very successful and has connections, but a very different sort of connection than that causes difficulties.
Yeah, no, I would say, see, one thing, and I repeat myself, the opposite of addiction is connection. Now what happens, sometimes what happens with success, I think you become disconnected from yourself only, and it becomes too difficult to manage. I think the best example are the Beatles. Because you're 17 years old, everybody wants you. Where you go and sleep, people cut squares out of your bed sheets and sell them for cash. And you're getting all this, you're only living in recording studios or five-star hotels. And you're doing it for 2 years. I think anybody would be lost with that kind of success because you're not interacting with people only. So I think when it begins for successful, very successful people, it will begin with a disconnect with themselves. And then they're disconnected from everything. I met a lot of successful people and they're not connected to anyone. And I'm talking about people. I'm not saying you can connect to money, you can connect to power. I'm not talking about that. I'm talking about connecting with human beings. Because my brain is 3.5 pound mass of fat in a skull cave. It can't even see anything. So I need another brain for my existence. I mean, how do I know I exist? You know what I mean? Because of you, I know I exist. Because right now, she's responding to me. If I keep talking to the wall, how do I know I exist? Because there wouldn't be any biofeedback. There wouldn't be any response coming from your side. So all I'm saying is, I mean, to put it in a nutshell, A, can anybody give up alcohol? At least as far as I'm concerned, I don't think so. Everybody can give up. There is a point of no return, you know? So we are talking about this person because this is one of the, probably the only person I know, maybe few persons, who've come back from the point of no return. Nobody else has seemed to have done that because once, have you all heard of things like Korsakoff psychosis? I mean, when you're going to give up alcohol, you see animals and you see snakes and you see actual visuals you get of this when you're in that stage. Right? Now, when go beyond that stage, I mean, I'm sure God can help and all, but I do not know a method to help every alcoholic because it's possible sometimes that it is too late.
And tell us about the families. It seems like the hardest thing for anyone would be to be related to someone who's an addict. How do they deal? How much is their responsibility?
Firstly, I tell you the pain. I think for an alcoholic, at least there's some release when he's on alcohol because alcohol is a solution. But for his family, there's absolutely no release. They are in that constant grind. So I think the damage it does to the family is much more than the damage it does to the individual. See, if I had cancer, by the time I die, all the people around me rally and get closer to each other. But if I'm an alcoholic or drug addict, by the time I die, this whole thing gets disjointed. Because I'm playing one against the other, I'm shouting at the house, I'm screaming in the house. I mean, even the good ones, the guys who have not been negative, right? Some people like play them bhai and dawn after they get high. But even the good guys, I mean, I had a patient, very nice guy, very decent guy, good family. The only problem was his children used to be terrified because he used to come back at 4 in the morning drunk with jalebis and he would wake them up and feed them jalebis and teach them about life, the meaning of life, and they have to go back to sleep and get up at 6 o'clock for school. So I think every alcoholic damages his family and tremendously. It's very unfortunate in India, in some homes, you know, it's, I don't know what it is, but it's quite a fancy line that now, Betty, you are going to that home, now your Arthi will come from that home. So even if that guy is messing around, the parents are not playing ball. You know, so I think it is a bigger social problem than people think it is. Because what do you do? Imagine, I am the breadwinner of my family. I have a wife. I have 4 kids. I am the alcoholic. Can you imagine their lives? You cannot. It's horrible. Because I decide right and wrong when I'm blown. I'm blowing up my cash. I keep shouting at everybody. I don't let anybody sleep in the house. And you can't send me for treatment because I'm holding the cash. You know what I mean? If I'm the son, then my father can send me for treatment. What if I'm the dad? Nobody can do anything to me. And it's, I don't know. I mean, it is so sensitive and so painful. I don't even want to talk about it. Because.
But is there some way that you would advise a spouse, a husband or wife in this position? Are there any better ways to deal with it than not?
No, I think that my only advice is that if it is possible, then you tell your husband, I'm going to my mom's home. If you're scared, just go to your mom's home. Without telling your husband, tell him, if you're okay, I don't mind coming back with the kids and fight to the finish. No? Because if you're going to stay there and keep enabling that behavior, keep commissioning that behavior, why would it stop? It will not stop at all. So my only advice to any woman married to such a guy is that please go to your mom's home. Now 60% of them can't because they're not welcome. So I think that we have to start teaching parents that, you know, I mean, for bliss, it is impossible for my daughter. I'm just convincing her the good age to marry is 45 to 50.
I don't believe you, Mom. No, but in terms of handling pressure at home, and you're right that the enablers are there, therefore one has to perhaps walk out and leave them to it. But that's pretty painful. I mean, how are you going to expect to be happy when you know the other person's probably out on the street? It's easier said than done, right?
No, it's easier said than done, but there has to be tough love because it always works. So, like say it's a child and he doesn't want to give up alcohol, I tell the parents you have to have tough love, no? One, don't tolerate that behavior. So when we talk about alcohol being bad, even for the people whom alcohol is bad, alcohol-related behaviors are worse. We're talking about alcohol-related behaviors. So we just say, don't tolerate it. And tell the person, I mean, you can't force anybody to give up alcohol or drugs. Nobody can be forced to give up, you know what I mean? But you can tell the person that, cut out the love, go for treatment, and we are there. So whenever you be clean, you will see the love. Until that time, you don't want to show you the love. It's okay. You know, because don't play that game. Because one thing you can't do is con a con man. Now, normal human beings have a long-term self-interest in life. But the alcoholic is just thinking of tomorrow. He's not thinking of tomorrow, he's thinking of today. So if you are my parent and you have to tell me, don't drink. I got the point from tomorrow, we're not drinking. And this keeps happening every day. So how do you play with that? I would just say, don't take the nonsense. If it is, unfortunately, it is not possible for everybody not to take the nonsense because of their financial constraints. But I would just tell one thing, if you really want to help alcoholism in the future, reduce the pain of the family, there's only one thing to do. Tell all the women in the world that financial independence is the backbone of human independence. And when the blisses grow up to be financially independent, I think they'll be able to tackle this problem. We won't be able to.
So are more men by data, or by everything we know around the world, far more likely to be alcohol addicts than women?
No, I think more males who are likely to present themselves for treatment. You know, because I have also had families where the son and the daughter are on alcohol, but the son will be sent to treatment and the daughter will not, because society will find out and who will marry her. It's like a weird thing. So I think the way I see it, obviously there are less women, the way I see it. But the way I know it, I think less women are just presenting themselves for treatment. It's like, if you go to centers all over India, is it that only the rich and the middle class are more into drugs? It seems like that to me, but I'm sure there are more. It's as much, because I've seen it's as much in the lower class, but they don't present themselves for treatment.
It may also be about access. Women, do they have as much access to alcohol and substance as the men do?
No, they have, obviously women, but I think they have, except for in the middle class. If you take out the middle class, in the rich class there is, and in the poor class there is. But I mean, there's a good band of middle class we have in this country, you know. So over there is different, because there I think most middle class will have a high value system. You know, the poorer class doesn't have it and the very rich guys don't have it. So I think you should just work hard to get belong to the middle class.
Doc makes these sweeping statements which we shall not question at this point. But should we open it out to questions? I'm sure
we'll open
lots
it out
of
to questions.
Yeah. Someone's taking the mic around. Yeah.
Good afternoon, sir. I'm Apurva Parekh. कौन कहता है शराब में नशा है अगर शराब में नशा है तो बोतल नहीं जुमती दैट इज द कॉमन एडेज सो आई वांटेड टू आस्क यू अ क्वेश्चन मोस्ट ऑफ द रेवेन्यूज ऑफ द गवर्नमेंट एक्साइज ड्यूटीज एंड ऑल कम्स फ्रॉम सेलिंग लिकर अल्कोहल इन गुजरात अ प्रोहिबिशन स्टेट यू विल फाइंड पर्संस गेटिंग अल्कोहल ड्रिंकिंग मेरिली एंड गोइंग टू राजस्थान एंड ड्रिंकिंग No alcoholic anonymous organizations have failed to stop this addiction. Alcohol has destroyed many lives. So, in spite of the disclaimer, you find an actor drinking in a film. Alcohol is injurious to health. How many in today's world take care of these disclaimers and refrain from taking?
I didn't understand the question, but talking about prohibition, you know, what I really believe is that we do not need prohibition. Because it's like, you know, prohibiting sugar or something. We don't need that. What I am suggesting is that everybody doesn't become an alcoholic. So it is basically it's your free will, you have to decide. Like Dr. Merchant has decided he cannot drink because he knows he cannot. Now other people don't know, right? But by prohibiting it, you're not helping anyway. So, I mean, I don't know. I'm not a guy for prohibition and all.
So what do you think the role of the state should be in something? Is this a completely personal problem?
No, I think the role of the state really should be that they should invest a lot into prevention programs in schools or colleges and educate the kids. You know what I mean? Because we keep telling everybody, alcohol is bad, to mar jayega, cirrhosis of liver hoga. He goes and drinks wine. He said, boss, ye toh bahut achha yaar. So, I mean, I think what we have to do is spread an education. You know, we have to have a outside information, dissemination, campaign, and the truth, not lies. If you go and keep scaring kids, the alcohol is bad and all, when they drink, they find out you're lying. So they don't understand why it is bad. So if they knew, it's like, do you really think we should prohibit sugar from Maharashtra? Because the diabetics are getting screwed. The diabetics have got to get the point, it's bad for me. So I don't think, I mean, sorry, but I don't think I'm in that prohibition zone. Or if you have a little baby, you have a dialect, you have a little bit of a dialect. Anyway, next question.
Next question, yeah.
Is addiction to drugs worse than...
I can't see, actually, there's too much light. Who's talking? I mean,
somebody. Wait, who's speaking? We can't see.
Okay, there,
oh,
sorry.
There you are. Okay, there.
Is addiction to drugs worse than the addiction to alcohol? I mean, I know all addiction is bad, but is drugs worse than alcohol? Or because you know, there's a stigma attached to drugs, but alcohol is socially very acceptable. So,
no,
which is?
Ma'am, I have a definition for alcohol. Alcohol is a drug in liquid form. It is the same thing.
Okay.
But because there's more stigma attached to drugs, and there are drugs that are different types, no? One of the drugs is alcohol. Alcohol is a drug in liquid form.
Okay. Okay.
But even the newer drugs seem to be giving a quicker high, and they're washed out by the body quicker. So they're going to have much more of a problem, no? Because my alcohol, I have a certain amount of consumption I can do. With drugs, I can use drugs that 5,000 rupees a gram and smoke 9 grams a day. That is 45,000 a day.
And, what about now they're making marijuana socially, recreational marijuana is legitimized in Canada and all. So do you approve of that, or do you think
See, it is recognized in Canada, it is recognized in the US, it was recognized in India since the Opium Act came in 1860.
Yeah.
It was recognized here also. But I have no take on that. All I'm saying is that I wouldn't be a part of a campaign to legalize marijuana in India, even though it is a natural substance.
Yeah.
Because even snake poison is a natural substance.
Yeah.
I think poison ivy is also a natural substance. They don't make it in the labs. So just because it is a natural substance, it doesn't mean anything. But I think the drug addicts and the alcoholics are damaged more by psychiatrists and their medication than the original drugs. So if you're asking me, is a host of psychiatric medicine more dangerous than marijuana, the answer is yes. It is.
So are you saying no medication is required at all for treatment?
No, I'm not saying no medication is required, but usually what happens in India, you know, we have these, most of the centers will have a lot of people clubbed together and the doctors can't handle them. So they just zap them, on medicines. It's an easy way. So I think psychiatry is actually looking more at helping the parent, actually helping the guy who has the cash, whether it's the parent or the child. You know, they don't bother. So as long as I've taken your misery away, you think everything is fine.
So these are mostly sedatives which will quiet the person.
Sedatives, tranquilizers, hypnotics, antipsychotics. I mean, any patient who's come to me from another psychiatrist who's taken alcohol or drugs, he's got the whole range. So whether you have schizophrenia, whether you have bipolar disorder, whether you have OCD, whether you have ADHD, the medicines are for all of them. So I would suggest that, I don't know, I mean, a doctor can harm the patient more than the drug can harm the patient, actually, just by giving random patient.
Anybody else with a question? Yeah, whoever.
Yes, who has the mic?
You were talking about what the state can do. Our state, Maharashtra state, what can they do about it? The jurisdiction, has to be changed. The law has to be changed, like in the Europe or the US. If you are caught driving under influence of alcohol, you are supposed to do some social work. Here you just put them behind the bar and forget about it. There's some program called Alcoholics Anonymous, where they are asked to attend these programs for a period of months together, and that's how it helps them.
No, but I understand what you're saying. But I mean, I would request the audience to ask me alcohol-related questions, you know. Just because I'm sitting on stage, I don't know all the answers. I don't know about law and what the hell you do with the legislation and all. So just please ask me only questions on alcohol. Because just because I'm here, it doesn't mean I know all the answers. So you're asking random questions, you know.
Okay.
Hello, sir. Sorry. Good afternoon. Hello.
Here. Where? There? Okay.
Huh? Yeah. You're a therapist. What is your view about groups like Alcoholics Anonymous and the family support groups like Al-Anon?
They're very nice. See, any kind of a self-help group, whether it is Alcoholics Anonymous, Narcotics Anonymous, I mean, they also have results. A lot of people, when I started actually, I started by understanding alcohol through Alcoholics Anonymous meetings. I did not understand alcohol in the psychiatry department. So I think it's very good. Any kind of a self-help group is very good. And I think as far as Alcoholics Anonymous are concerned, a hell of a lot of people are clean and they're maintaining to be clean. I have a different school of thought. But A is a very good thing.
Yeah.
Anybody?
He's got the mic, is there.
Thank you for the talk, Dr. Merchant.
You know, it's really hard for us to hear on stage. So if you could sort of stand up and speak a little loudly.
Yeah, is this better? Yeah, thank you for your talk. You made a very interesting point in there that even when you take away the alcohol, somehow the addictive patterns continue. So I really want to know if you've visited any of the places which has prohibition in India today, and if you found these patterns coming in once the alcohol is taken away, and if you find one pattern occurring more frequently than the rest.
Well, I would only say one thing.
Yeah.
You have to physiologically and psychologically decouple the person from alcohol. Right? The physiological decoupling has to happen. And sometimes you need to be in a hospice environment. Because if you're taking alcohol to a certain degree, sometimes you go through delirium tremens. It's a condition where one out of four will die, no matter what you do. So firstly, the physiological disconnect has to happen, right? Then you're talking about the psychological disconnect. So for the psychological disconnect, he has to form a new pattern in a sanitized environment. He just can't do it at home where there's so much of sensation. You know, it's the same mom, the same wife, the same bathroom, the same place as to hide alcohol, all that. So I didn't understand your question, but all I'm saying is, in order to create a new pattern, first he has to remove the old pattern. So I think any rehab process is more about unlearning than it is about learning. Because he has to unlearn those patterns of behavior. Understand what I'm saying?
Are you asking what patterns he has observed in alcohol abuse behavior? And
after they're clean.
Yeah.
No, what I've seen is that, see, as far as I'm concerned, that the guys become normal. Their addictive personality is on in some form. Quite a few of them just put it into work and they excel. But there would be a lot of people, if you're not treated properly, then they would be still in those hang-ups that they originally had. Maybe guilt. So I would say that for a rehab process to work, it should be at least 1 year long. Because if it's going to be a 28-day thing like they do in the United States of America, because insurance pays for 28 days, nobody's going to give up anyway. Yeah.
I'm an NRI, not required Indian, and I live in Japan. And I've observed there that there's a culture of drinking. Alcohol is available in vending machines, and kids start as young as 12 and 13 to help themselves with alcohol. By the time they're grown up, they're fully fledged alcoholics. Then there's a culture that you drink with your boss after the work day and with the customers, and you drink till you're puking on the street. And I've seen this with my own eyes. So what does one do in a culture like that? A. Secondly, now they've started that if you drink and drive, not only are you responsible, but your host who supplied you with the drinks, whoever else was concerned, is how far do you think that would work in India, something like that?
No. Firstly, I think that this is not rocket science. You can't have alcohol and all vending machines, alcohol and cigarettes. There should be a minimal age, whatever they have, 18 or whatever, then they can decide what they want to do. So I think that is the first part of your question. Second is, I don't know if it will work in India. I don't think the vending machine will also work. Or I don't think that if you hold parents responsible for their children, it'll work. I mean, in India, though, I think nobody's responsible for themselves also. So where will they be responsible for others? So I think that is a very little high utopian thing, you know. I try to convince all my patients, boss, you are responsible for your actions.
So, Doc, are most people in denial when they come to you?
No, not most people are not in denial when they come to me, but I think some of them are. Because when they're in denial, they do not come to me. Because they think they don't have a problem. Only when the problem goes there. So most of them, I mean, some of them would be in denial if, like, let's say the dad is strong, the mom is strong, the kid is an alcoholic. So he's brought to me. But what if the dad is an alcoholic? He continues to be in denial till he dies. So, I mean, that nothing can be done. Anyone, wherever the mic is. Actually, if you don't mind, I'll stand, because when I stand, at least I can see you.
Thank you so much, Dr. Saab. You made a definition of an alcoholic as somebody who starts drinking and cannot stop. I would say I fit in the other category. I'm a person who's in control. I can drink one peg, I can drink half a bottle, but I can stop anytime. I cannot drink for a whole year. I can drink every day and I'm in control. So what's your opinion on the kind of motivators for drinking alcohol for my kind of people, which I assume is true for most of the people here also?
No, but if you don't have a problem, keep drinking, na?
Is that as simple as that?
Of course. If you don't have a problem, what's the problem? Why do you want to create a problem if you don't have a problem? Then you enjoy your drinks.
Hello, sir. Sir, just now you told that medicines are more harmful for alcoholic and drug addicts. So what they should do? They should continue with alcohol and drug? Can you please elaborate on that?
No, no. What I mean to say is that number one, if you are giving, you have to give medicine to a person during the detoxification process. After that, when he's physiologically decoupled, he actually does not need medicines. See, my problem, if I'm an alcoholic, is I cannot deal with reality, right? That is my problem. Let's say Kartika doesn't know math. She doesn't know mathematics. What tablet to give her? I can give her a tablet, she'll forget she doesn't know mathematics, but she'll not know mathematics. So I have to just learn how to deal with reality. There's no tablet for that. So if I have got some trauma in the past, there's no tablet for that. If I've got frustrations, there's no tablet for that. If I'm a very sensitive person, I keep getting hurt all the time, there's no tablet. If I'm self-consumed and selfish human being, there's no tablet for it, no? So that's what I'm saying. So the shortcut, I mean, when I was in JJ Hospital, I began in JJ Hospital, we had 70 patients in the ward. Now, how do I talk to 70 patients every day? Suppose, how's everything? Cool. Okay. Next, next, next. And all I'm doing is continue same treatment for all. So there have been, is there any person who's been to a psychiatrist over here for a long time? There have been people for 25 years, they are getting the same dose. Even JJ Hospital has to do that only, has to write CTOL. Because my head of the department said, you cannot prescribe anything because I was new. Just write CTOL, mean continue same treatment. And the case people are 25, 30 years old, we just continuing same treatment. So I don't know what we were doing. So in order to answer your question, all I'm saying is that medicines are required in the process of detoxification and physiological decoupling, not for psychological rehab. Like if a guy is beating up his wife, I mean, what tablet do you give him? You know what I mean? So, but what a psychiatrist will do, he'll give you Serenes. And then you'll become like a popot and sit in a corner spit from here. Then the person, I see vast improvement. Because he is sitting like this. The vast improvement.
I think we have to stop now, right? We've run out of time, she says. So, I don't know, Doc, will you be kind enough to talk to them a little later, after the stage?
Just one second. I just want to say one thing. I was really hoping Pooja comes. Because I wanted to apologize to Pooja. Because today she didn't come for the show. But I think in 1992, she was supposed to come for my show in Ahmedabad. I was doing a show for the Gujarat government. And she was in severe abdominal pain. And she kept calling me and said, Doc, I'm really in pain. Can I skip it? Can I skip it? I said, please, Pooja, see, I'll get screwed, man. And she came with the pain. So I just wanted to apologize. It's just ironical that she didn't come today. But by the way, Pooja is a wonderful human being. She must be doing something busy. She must be busy with something somewhere. Look at her, because she was standing. Mic. And then we end.
So I'll make it really short. You mentioned right at the beginning of the session that addiction is at the opposite spectrum of connection. We live in a time of internet connectivity. Okay, a lot of people are thinking addiction patterns are now growing, even in younger people, because there's no genuine connect on the internet. It's very passive. I wanted to understand whether you have seen that shift in your career, healing people and working with people. With the internet, we've actually got more disconnect and more addiction.
100%. I agree with you because, see, on the internet, we have 4,000, 5,000 friends. It's not possible to have 4,000, 5,000 meaningful relationships. And I think I'll tell you what's bad about the internet, why it is contributing to all this shit. Because what happens, let us say you and your boyfriend or husband fight, or you all break up. Then the internet has kept a way to track the person. So when if I go on Kartika's internet, the Facebook, she'll be like this. But if she goes on mine, I'm also like this. So both think each other is happy, but nobody is happy. No, nobody's going to put sad pictures on the internet. So the more, there's a study done on this. The longer you're on Facebook, the more likely you're to be depressed. Because you keep seeing everybody else seems to be happy, except for me. But even you're only putting happy pictures, no? That